Okay, thank you, and thank you for the organizer, he's here, for inviting me and a nice conference. So if maybe I first explain what is a linear drift, what kind of drift I'm talking about. The setting is I have a compact manifold. Compact Riemannian manifold. And I look at the universal cover, and on the universal cover, I lift the metric. So I have a metric on the universal cover, which is invariant by the group of deck transformation. And on that space, I have the Laplace Beltrami operator. And if I have the Laplace, I mean, that's something which is given to me by the metric, and also what is given to me by the metric is the heat kernel. Heat kernel tells you how the heat diffuses on the manifold. You burn the manifold at a point, and you look at how the heat diffuses with time. And in more mathematical terms, it's a fundamental solution. it's a kernel such that if I want to solve du over dt u on m tilde, and u of x0, 0, then I have u of x integral of pt y of y, where dy is the Riemannian volume. So in that sense, it solves the heat equation on the manifold. So I have this object, which is very natural, and the drift I want to talk about is comes from the following proposition, which is not very hard to prove. So the following limit exists and is independent of x. Limit I have in mind is L, maybe sometimes L underline, it depends on G. The limit as T goes to infinity of 1 over T, integral of dxy, of txy, dy. So you have the heat which diffuses, and you are wondering how fast it diffuses to infinity. In time t, it goes, the heat is distributed roughly at distance Lt. So L is a nice, so it's a, you can think of it as a global invariant of the compact manifold. And the fact that the limit exists, it's almost by sub-additivity, I mean, the sequence is almost sub-additive except for the error at the beginning. And the fact the quotient is compact means that the error at the beginning is not important. And I mean, it's an exercise to show that it does not depend on x and the limit exists. Okay, and it's a nice number. I mean, and it has property, rigidity property, can be compared with that. So just to mention it, recall that L is smaller than E, which is a volume entropy. It goes to infinity of 1 over T log of volume of B of XT. So that's one number, and it's bigger than
square root of n minus 1 A, where A is minimum or maximum, something, minus the minimum, yeah. Minus the minimum, 0 and the minimum of x of the Ricci curvature. So it's some number, and of course, I mean, you can ask whether you have rigidity when you have equality, and you sometimes you have, but you need. Sometimes you have if you make more hypotheses. But I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about the regularity. Like in the course of Anton, I will consider lambda goes to G lambda, one parameter family of matrix, one parameter. Of matrix. So if the one parameter family of matrix, I have, for each one of them, I have my L G lambda. And the question is, assume that this has some regularity, how L changes. And the theorem, work in progress, I mean, it's a little embarrassing to say it's work in progress because I've been talking about that for several years now, but it's still work in progress with Lin Xu. So the best theorem, which is not proven yet, would be that if the family, so if the family is A, among K metric, then lambda goes to LG lambda is CK minus 2. Okay, so it's really work in progress. It's not proven yet. So what I will explain is the easy. Zero has negative curvature. Right. So I'm in the world of negative curvature because I like it. And if you have negative. I mean, you need some hypothesis of non-positive curvature or something to get, I mean, you need some hyperbolicity to get some positive number here. If you are on R, you know that the heat goes to the square root of T on Rn. So square root of T divided by T gives you zero. So if you want some interesting number here, you need to make some hypothesis. And the strongest hypothesis I want to do is assume that I start with negative curvature. And then we hope to have that kind of result. So what I will explain our proof in the case k equal 2. In that case, it's certainly not the simplest proof, but it's the one which extends to higher differentiability. And the case k equal 1 is written, but since we want to write everything together, it's it's not completely right. So what's the idea? So idea case k equal 2. So I have a C2 family of C2 matrix, and I want to show that the drift is continuous. And I'm sure you can do it directly, but I will do it in a very complicated way, which is the one we use afterwards. So the complicated way is to, because we are in negative curvature, we have a formula. So step one, to write a formula for
And to introduce the formula, I have to introduce several objects. So I'm in negative, so Mg has negative curvature. So it's the universal cover, then it's very nice. I mean, it's the picture that we know for the hyperbolic plane, and you can draw the same picture. So the universal cover is like a ball, and it has a boundary at infinity. And the boundary at infinity can be seen as a set of equivalence classes of geodesics. Two geodesics are equivalent if they remain at a boundary distance away from one another. And the set of equivalence classes is the boundary at infinity. It's a sphere. And in fact, it's a sphere which is homeomorphic. If I take any point in the universal cover, I look at the unit sphere around this point. Each geodesic goes somewhere and goes to infinity, and this map going from here to here is a homeomorphism between that sphere and the sphere at infinity. So instead of looking at T1 M tilde, I always identify with M tilde cross M tilde by this isomorphism. And in the same way, I mean, T1 M tilde divided by gamma, which is gamma is the fundamental group, is T1 M. So you need a tangent bundle to the M is divided by gamma. So gamma is the fundamental group of M, and we are in negative curvature. So M, it acts properly discontinuously on M tilde, and M is just the quotient. And gamma acts by isometry, so the unit tangent bundle, the quotient is exactly the unit tangent bundle. And here, the action of gamma is the action of the boundary. If I have one family of geodesic, I push them by gamma, I get another family of geodesic, and by isometry, I get another point at infinity. So I have the action of gamma extend here, and of course, T1m, so it's identified that way with the quotient on m cos tm tilde by. Why do I do that? Because it's very easy to, it's much better to write formula. I will make an abuse to write a formula which gives me L. I will make an abuse of notation, so Lg is given by the integral over T1m of bxc dm of x. And what do I mean by that? I will define b and I will define dm, which will be a function and measures on, which depend on the big space. But everything will be gamma equivariant. So everything is gamma equivariant. Eventually, I can integrate by the restriction of my measure to T1m, the function which is gamma equivariant. So it's completely abusive, but it's very convenient. So what is B? So I have x, a point x, and a point at infinity xc. And we've seen it already here. We have
We have a whole sphere, set of initial points of geodesic which go to infinity and converge with the one going. And my BXC is the mean curvature. Of the whole sphere is a codimension, I mean, a dimension n minus 1 in m tilde. So look at it's the mean curvature of the whole sphere at x with pole. So what is the mean curvature? When if you want to write formula, you can look at this field. I mean, this field of vectors. Xi defines a field of vectors on M tilde. And if I take the divergence, so Xi give me Xi, a field of vector on a vector field on M tilde. And so the mean curvature is just divergence. So that's what my integrand is, and it's clearly gamma invariant because everything is geometric. And my measure also is something we've seen already in the conference. For each point x, there's the harmonic measure. Mx. On the M tilde. And there are two ways of presenting it, as Anton recalled yesterday. I mean, either you think of it as the one which solves the Dirichlet problem at infinity from this object. Give a function at the boundary, extend it on a harmonic function inside, and it will be given by the integral with respect to mx. Or it can be also seen as the distribution, the exit distribution of the Brownian motion. Start with x, run the Brownian motion. We are in negative curvature. It goes to infinity. And it goes, and the distribution starting from x of the point at infinity is some probability. And again, it's geometric, so it's completely equivariant by gamma. So if I integrate d of x, c, dm, x, mx of dmx of xi, that's a function of x, but it's a function of x which is gamma invariant. Because everything, I mean, if I take at gamma x, I have to take b of gamma x, gamma xi, and dmx of gamma xi, but that's exactly the same thing. And so it's a function gamma invariant, so I can integrate it on m. So that's what I mean by this integral. With respect to the volume, or to the... And to have the formula which is exact, I have to take a probability. Okay, so that's the formula. Maybe I want to explain why it's true. And then, so the strategy will be, so I have this formula, and the strategy will be to show that those two objects vary regularly with the metric. So first I will explain the why the formula is true, and then I explain why they vary regularly. So why the formula is true? One way of proving it is to use the Brownian motion. On M tilde. What is it? It's a process. And I start from X. It's a Px, a probability measure. On space of trajectories. So what is the trajectory for the Brownian motion starting from X? So I have omega zero X. And omega, and that's the property that omega t has distribution. Y dy. And moreover, the probability is such that it has the Markov property and so on, but essentially that's what we use about it. Why do I want, because now I will be able to write my limit, which I already erased, but as a limit, so this guy is, so it's not nice, right? We are in an infinite measure space, it seems to be completely horrible, but again, it's a geometric object. So it's a geometric object, so I can project on my compact manifold, and then have, again, a probability measure on the space of trajectories on the compact manifold. But now, I mean, it's a process on a compact object. And so C R plus M now. And if I take the measure integral of, if I take the measure, Lebesgue measure, X, so divided by volume of M, is a probability measure on M, and it is a probability measure which is stationary for the Brownian motion, which means that if I start with that measure for omega zero, and I look at what happens at omega t, I still have the same measure. And moreover, it's ergodic. It's very easy to see that it's ergodic mixing. It's a very nice process. As the shift on the space of trajectories with that measure and the integral of that measure is a very nice ergodic system. And for that system, it's easy to see that LG, in fact, is given by a limit t goes to infinity of 1 over t distance of again, you have to play with the two levels. I start with the trajectory downstairs. I lift it over there. And I look at the distance, how far it gone. It gives me some number. And I'm saying that if I divide this number by t, this converges almost everywhere. Why it converges? Because it's for that system, for that nice finite measure ergodic system, it is a subadditive sequence. I have d omega 0 tilde omega tilde t plus s. Of course, it's rather than omega 0 omega tilde. That's just the triangle inequality. So the function which interests me at time t plus s is smaller than the same at time t, plus the one at time s shifted by t. So it's exactly a subadditive sequence. So by the subadditive ergodic theorem, I know that this converges almost everywhere to this convergence is almost everywhere at L1. So if it's L1 in particular, I can take the expectation. So I know that LG is the limit 1 over t of expectation starting from x of the distance from omega. So what is this guy, 1 over t distance of x? A fancy way of saying it is to apply Ito's formula, but you can also just take the derivative and say that it's the integral from 0 to t of the derivative with respect to t, and the derivative with respect to t is the generator applied to that function. So what I'm saying is that this guy is the same as limit t goes to infinity of 1 over t integral from 0 to t of delta d, delta y of dx. Delta d of x point taken at omega. S, yes. You want to make a... We can use Ito's formula, for instance, to do that, or you can take the derivative of this. And the derivative will involve the generator of the process, and the generator of the process is exactly a Laplacian. So you will have the Laplacian of the distance applied. So what is this? I start from x, and I go to omega tilde. And I'm looking at delta d. Delta d is the mean curvature of the sphere. Delta d, mean curvature of the sphere centered at x. In y, in omega t. Why? Right? I mean, it's the Laplacian of the distance, the mean curvature of the level set of the distance function. So now, but everything is gamma invariant. So what happens if I, instead of writing it that way, I look at all the omega tilde which project on the same point. So I'm trying to look at this expression, but seen from the point of view of the projection of omega tilde s on the manifold. So it will be something in y. So what will it be? I mean, it will be the mean curvature of the sphere centered at what? At the point for which I come. Okay, so maybe before doing that, I should say that as the distance goes to infinity, the mean curvature of the sphere centered at x is very close to the mean curvature, which is very close to what I call b of y vx, vyx. Now, vyx is the vector going from y to x. When the distance goes to infinity, the sphere looks more and more like the whole sphere, and looks more and more in a C2 way. So the mean curvature of the sphere centered at y and going to x is very close to the mean curvature of the whole sphere centered at y and going to that point, vx1, in the vy. So now to understand what is this when I take the expectation, because I am allowed to take the expectation, it's a convergence in MOTVA and in L1, I have to understand how the initial points are distributed when I arrive at the same point, at the point which project on the same y.
But the Brodmann motion is reversible, so it's the same as starting from Y and asking how the initial points are distributed. And they are distributed according to PTXY, to PTYX now. So the limit, so all this to have a countable family here, and a discrete family here, but when T goes to infinity, and if I take the expectation, limit will be what I claim it was, the integral of delta B, of B, with respect to the harmonic measure. So, but close to integral of B of X, Y, C, DMY. But Y is omega tilde T, so I have to take omega tilde T, S here, omega tilde S here, and I take 1 over T integral from 0 to T, yes, and by the ergodic theorem, already by taking the integral in S, this converges to what I claim, integral of B here. Okay, I'm juggling a little with the top and the bottom, but if you do it quietly, there is no. Okay, there's more learned way of describing it and describing this measure. If you are well educated, you know that the points which have the same xi on T, T1 and tilde are the stable manifold, and the quotient is exactly the stable foliation, central stable foliation. And what this proof does, I mean, exactly the same proof of Lucy Garnett, that the measure I described is a unique measure on the T1M, which is stationary for the Brodmann motion restricted to the stable foliation. I mean, that's exactly the same argument. You look at here and you look at what happens from that point. Okay, so that's the step one. So now I claim that to have a nice formula, here it is here. And now I claim that the elements of that formula are regular in when I change my metric. And as I said, I will make the proof in details for k equal 2, so are continuous for a C2 family. So what is this guy? So now I have a C2 family of and I have x and xi, and I look at the vector which goes from x to xi for the metric G0. So if I change the metric, I mean, it's not the same geodesic which goes from here to here, right? So if I change the metric, I will have a different length in the original metric, and I have a different direction to arrive at the same point at infinity. And the change from here to here, it's one version of another structural stability. And the statement is that as lambda goes to B lambda of X Xi is A minus 2 from minus epsilon epsilon for a small interval into some space of Hölder continuous function on T1M. Statement is that there is an alpha such that this function is Hölder continuous as a function from the parameter into the Hölder continuous function on T1. And it's a form of de la Yavé.
Marco Morian.
Stability, where they prove that if you look at the structural stability theorem of Morse, I mean the Morse correspondence, the map will give you so the one that they consider is different. It takes 2 points to infinity, and now I look at the map which goes from this to this one. But okay, you have a small change to do, but the change is very smooth. What they show is that this map is Hölder continuous. That's well known. The map cannot be more than Hölder continuous. But as a Hölder continuous map, it is as regular as possible. Because it is given by some implicit function theorem. So that's a wonderful paper that everybody should know. Okay, so that the first part of the B is nice. And what about M? So you want to show that M is depends regularly. Again, you try to find it as a fixed point of something. So for that, I define some operator on on the Hölder continuous function on one hand. What is the operator? A semi-group of operator. Qtf of x. So I take what I should take. I lift. So f tilde lift of f m tilde to t1 m tilde. And I take pt so this is an operator. So if I have a function, what do I do? I have a function at the point. I look at that vector. But that vector corresponds to some vector here. And I look at the function of the value of f here, and I take the average of all these values. And the fact I proved some time ago to prove the central limit theorem for this but is that such that alpha z c such that minus integral of f dm the norm of Hölder continuous function is smaller than C. So QT, M is invariant by this operator. You just have to write You just have to write what it means, and you'll see that the fact that M is invariant by the process tells you that M is invariant by this operator. And the fact is that not only is invariant, but the convergence is exponential if you restrict yourself to a space of continuous functions. Okay, so M is the fixed point
is the unique fixed point, the isolated fixed point. Of the conjugate, the conjugate space. So if I change my lambda goes to g lambda of t x y. Okay. And the proof of this is uniform in a neighborhood of g lambda zero. So this operator changes continuously, and as an operator in k alpha. So the fixed point m lambda continuous from minus epsilon epsilon to k alpha. Now we are in good shape because we have our formula is the integral of a regular continuous function with respect to a measure, but the measure depends continuously more than not only weakly, but as an element of the dual of the continuous function. And the continuous and the function itself depend continuously in that space. Maybe it's not the same alpha, but you take the smallest of the smaller of the. Okay, so that proves the continuity. Now we have to prove the higher order. So what do we have to prove? For the B, it's already in the Ledrappier-Moyen. We have the regularity that we want for B. So the thing to prove is that QT is regular. So the question, so K bigger than 2. We want to prove that QT is regular. And if you look the way QT is defined, essentially you want to prove that lambda y is smooth in lambda, is C1 in lambda, CK minus. Lambda with some control of the change, which allowed you to say that the map would be also CK as a map in that space. Okay, so we were there a couple of years ago, and we saw that it was clear that it's not a very. And you start looking in the books, and we never found anywhere that such a result. So we start trying to prove it. And the idea to prove it, what do we have? As Anton explained yesterday, what we have, the way of describing the Brownian motion, is described by a flow. But the flow, I'll also explain, you have to go first to the frame bundle and then define the stochastic differential equation of the frame bundle. So we have a frame bundle. So since we change metric, we take all possible frame, but we start with the orthonormal frame. And if we start with the orthonormal frame, we stay with the orthonormal frame at least. So contrary to Anton this morning, I fix my G and then I change the parameter. I don't change both at the same time. A priori, it should be simpler, but. And then what do I do? And then there is a map. So if I have x0, u0, I take an initial orthonormal frame. So I will take u0 orthonormal. U0 And then, I will, I'm not able to make the nice picture Anton did yesterday, but you have a flow, which starting from x naught u naught, you have a map phi from x naught u naught, which gives you x t u t, but the map itself is random. So all the randomness, the map is very regular. I mean, it's given by the the solution of the equation, but the randomness is in the map. The map is indexed by the Brownian motion on Brownian trajectory on Rn, and the randomness is in the map. And what happens when I change my metric? So I change my starting point. I have to find the canonical way to go from here to here, but Gram-Schmidt, for instance, I mean, that's not. But also, I change my map, and there are results in the stochastic, stochastic differential equation will depend on a parameter. Then everything is smooth, I mean, everything which depends, which you define, and the map, the everything you can compute, depends smoothly on the parameter. I mean, depends as regularly as. So, lambda, u, t, lambda. And we know that lambda goes to phi lambda is regular. That's not enough. And unfortunately, that's not enough to get the result. Maybe I can write a few equations to see to show where the problem is. So I want to show that p lambda txy prime at lambda equals 0 is something like p txy and some function which I can control. What is this? So what I can do is that the expectation starting from x of f, what is p over f, is a guy which tells me the integral of f of y pt y, that's the formula I had before, is the solution. So it's expectation starting from x of f of. So what can I do? So if I differentiate, so this prime at lambda equals 0 is the expectation starting from x of what? Of gradient f. And I have to take, if I have to go in the in the unit tangent, in the frame bundle to write this. And in the frame bundle, I know how to differentiate this. For each omega, I have so some vector here. Defi 5 prime at lambda equals 0, which is a vector. And I can write this again as an integral from gradient f, phi prime, ptxy. But if I want to write it that way, I have to make an integration by part. So I have to show that this guy depends C1 or CK of y. So the problem, what remains to do, is that I have this phi lambda, have the derivative of phi lambda, which are very nice, and given by the stochastic differential equation, which are very nice. But I want to show that the solution depends C1, say, on the point. And it's a little like, I mean, there are classical results saying that PTXY depends mostly on Y. It has been, it's classical in PDE, but it's also classical in probability. There are several proofs, but I think Bismuth is the first one, and Elton Chu, and Driver, and Anton. I mean, and there are proofs, but the problem here is that we are on a big space, and we are not elliptic at all. So qualitatively, we know that we have enough derivative to have a condition like that. But to have an estimate on this guy, we need to write explicitly what is what is explicitly the Gerzanov formula, which when you vary y, when you take a vector field y, you have to go back your phi prime and follow, which is all the coefficients are defined by stochastic differential equation, so you have to go back and to control that you it doesn't become too crazy. Maybe so we think we can do it for k at 1, and we are still discussing for k bigger than. We have arguments. I mean, I think it's okay, but it's not right. Maybe I stop here.